All right.
So it's important to learn this is a transitional class for all of us when we take it. I try to, it's all about serving you guys for the future. And one thing that's critical to learn is that you can't start homework for these subjects the night before. It's not like that. You have to start, and particularly to make this class work well, more and more people are using this idea of flipping. I'm actually presenting at a conference next weekend on some of these ideas and discussing, you know, there's ways to do it, ways not to do it. It's tricky. I mean, I could try to come up with some punitive thing for you when you don't prep, but you have to figure that out too yourself. But because it's a more effective learning cycle, that takes a lot of discipline, but the results are great. Like on the weekend, you know, used to be, we cover chapter 9, and then at the end of the next week, you do chapter 9 while I'm talking about chapter 10, which is really stupid, right? Because you're not hearing a word I'm saying. But that's the way we did it. It's just a horrible learning cycle. Now it's this weekend, you work on it, get in there, and then we fine-tune it and take you to depths that are going to be valuable and substantial learning. So try to do it. It takes discipline, but it is easier, actually. And so when you fall back, which we all do, to the old ways, you realize, oh, that is painful. Eventually, you just do it because it's the easiest thing to do. So I encourage you to do that. I've got torque notes like crazy. I think I'm going to show you, I'm going to show you that and this and other things. Lots of examples here. So the punchline is, though, and this is why the homework is due, you know, 11:59 on Friday, except this weekend I will extend it a little bit. If you've done it, better, you know, absolutely better. You want to, it's, your grade is, should be a reflection of how deep you've gone. And here, guess what? Your depth is going into seeing the force and the line of action, seeing R and the line of R, which again is my terminology, but seeing F perpendicular or tangent, and perpendicular to what? To the line of R. R perpendicular to the line of F, or action as it's called, and then seeing the angle between the lines. I'll just say it that way. And if you can take it methodically, and I really encourage you, even if you think you can get away without it, for now, use that table and use it the way that I've shown you, then do a bunch of problems. The rest is there. Rotational inertia, will I resist alpha? I resist alpha, it's like a t-shirt. Torque net causes alpha, bang. That's the physics, right? So I can speed it up, I can slow it down, I can even twerk it. So there's one thing that you'll need to know here, and I think I'll hold that up. Let's look at units and a little tricky business about units. So this is, I don't know what page, if you have the new notes. Now, again, keeping track of stuff is hard, so find a way. This is, I asked you guys to bring these, but you know, page 1, page 2, page 3, it's called twisted at the top of the page. If not, I'll do it here. I know it'd be kind of, I used to have people buy a reader, but a lot of the stuff I put on the YouTube and you can take notes, so I don't know what's best. And so I try to make some copies for you guys. But bringing these notes, So watch this. This is weird, but it makes sense. Let's review. Here's an object that has inertia and gravitational property of m. Oh, that's interesting. Sorry. A little processing. Here's a force. If that object doesn't move, how much work does the force do? Zero. It doesn't mean it's not expending energy. Again, yeah, you can expend energy all you want. You can push on something and turn it. You're not giving it energy until you speed it up. You're not taking it away until you slow it down. Right? And of course you can lift and things like that. So it's only the part of the force that is parallel to the displacement, right? And we have to follow along the path. So, I don't know, I'll just call it delta x for now, or d, whatever. And so we know that work, of course, is composed of the part with the motion, f parallel to the displacement, and that's the one that does work. Just a little review. If you can pull this together, you're going to be really well set to do all this cool stuff that's happening today. I mean, it's an exciting time to be in science and engineering. And F perpendicular to the displacement. Does that do work? Does that do work, guys? We'll go faster if you... Does not do work. Because work, we mean force that's trying to make it speed up. But who knows? Maybe there's friction, which is doing negative work. Right? Is the normal force doing work? No. What about gravity? No. Okay, so with work, you could take it one force at a time. But remember, it's the net, like the network, or the total from all forces causes a change in kinetic energy. I call that form one. And we said, hey, what do I have to deal with that guy? I can move that over. And the work from all non-conservative then is E later minus E or little review, and oh yeah, what are the units of energy? Units of work and energy. What's a joule? It's a newton times a meter. Is that meter parallel to the force or perpendicular to the force?
Parallel.
Now I'm going to do it this way. That's my own little notation, because that's a joule. Now watch. Ready? Here we go. That M needs to be redone. Okay. So now let's do this. Let's take an object. You can take a physical pivot point or just a mathematical choice. We'll call that the origin or the axis, either way. And I'm going to exert a force. Let's exert that force. I don't know, it doesn't matter, this way. Good old free body diagram, we just do forces, we don't draw torques, right? Right here. Okay, so this force has parts. Now, what I look at now, by the way, when I deal with forces, I might use coordinates. Here I'm going counterclockwise, clockwise. I'm looking at torque. I need a good old R. Where's R?
from the axis of rotation.
From the axis of rotation to the, what I call this right here? Point of application of the force. It's just increasing your awareness. You guys can master this. I so wish you would, for your sake. Or, so I'm going to look at force in terms of R. What part of R is torquing? What part of F? Let's look at F. What part of F is torquing? Which part? Yeah, this guy. The one that's tangent, the one that goes around. You don't torque unless you push it around, right? So I'm going to do this. F perpendicular to the line of R, right? Or tangent. Does that torque?
No.
That one torques. Oops. Sorry. Such a colorful bottle. I'm making a connection here. But what about the force parallel to R? Force parallel to R.
Does that torque?
Does not torque. What are the units, real quick? These are little things, you know, but you gotta clean up the little things. Well, let's see, the torque from any single force, in this case F, is equal to, would this be clockwise or counterclockwise?
Counterclockwise.
Imagine holding it there, pushing it. Whether or not physically, again, it's moving, you just, if that's your axis, you imagine no other forces, do that, it's going to make it go around that way, right? Counterclockwise, which could be plus or minus, I don't know. And then I'm going to look at it this way, R vector magnitude times the force perpendicular to the line of R. Cool? Questions? Do stop me. This is about now. You can have this now so you can do all the ladder problems and the door problems. Are we cool? I want to look at units. What are the units of torque? What are the units of R?
Meters.
What are the units of force? Newtons. And it doesn't matter which way you write it. So that's a newton meter, right? So is that a joule? No. You go, well, are you pushing it a distance, R? No, it's different, isn't it? So here's my little thing, if you want. This is a meter. That's meter here. It's not a meter you moved or a meter that is perpendicular to the force. A meter perpendicular versus a meter parallel. That's a joule. That's not a joule. Right? It's a weird little distinction. So just know. And a lot of people do use meter newtons or newton meter as a unit of torque. Most of the world. We might, however, use foot pound. Because remember, force is in pounds, not kilograms, even though a lot of the world uses weight in kilograms, which is wrong because it's mass. So they're all wrong. But you can get away with it if you don't leave the planet. How many meters, how many feet is a meter? About 3 feet, right? How many pounds is a newton? Quarter, right? Roughly. So a meter newton is about 3/4 of a pound, of a foot pound. And if you do it, you'll see it's good. It's pretty close. So that's interesting to know. If you're doing mechanical system, that's the stuff you gotta know, more than calculus, right? So you should know that those, and if you don't think about that, then again, you're the engineer that everybody laughs at. So they're about the same. Interesting. Questions? Good, do some more. Good. We're just gonna ramp up now.
All the way on the left, below I resist alpha, I just didn't get the last one.
Oh, torque net causes alpha. Net. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. That's the physics. You know the physics. You use it. You just need to calculate it. That's the extra level of design and engineering. You better have a sense of what we're doing. That's the thing. You can get this. A lot of people don't, though, so let's make it different this time, you know. And so now we just have to see the physics in the picture, and one by one, take each force. It's going to be a mess. You don't have to do it all at once. In fact, when you create this messy equation, you can go, yeah, I did it. And your friends will go, oh, you're a genius. And you go, yeah. So, cool?
The last line is one.
I'm sorry, 1 meter newton is about 3/4 of a foot pound, because I put a meter is about 3 feet, a newton's less, about 1/4 pound. But it'd be interesting and worthy of you doing at least once to actually put the conversion in to see, is it closer or further?
I thought the approximate sign was an N.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's my squiggly equal.
It should be a double. Thanks.
Yeah, so cool. You know, and if we don't talk about that, that's annoying. When you think about it, you go, what, what? And you might start writing joules. And then you really, it's confusing at first. So here we go. Let's do this. Let's do a force couple. A force couple, as I describe in your notes on the next page of the notes, is something that you use in a very clever way in your engineering statics course, our 255 course. It's really clever. So clever, I forget how to do it. I mean, I kind of do. When I took that class, actually, it was pretty easy. And unfortunately, our first exam, the professor is this British guy. And for some reason, it was a small class. But he wrote the exam. The average was 90. If you got a 90, you got a C. And that was because you made an algebraic mistake. Yeah, that was not right. That was not right. I'm glad I didn't make an algebraic mistake. So, you know, so I got an A and my friend got a C. Dude, he knew it. Like, that's not fair. So, it can happen. We argued, too. It was like, I mean, it was just too easy an exam, right? Which is ironic, because usually it's too hard an exam. Usually average like 30 sometimes. So, you know, getting you ready for that strange, wacky world of upper division where professors are doing their research and might spend a few minutes writing an exam. So, here we go. Not always. Great. Here, I want you to explore this situation. Imagine some sort of rod or stick, and maybe you've got it. I'm sorry if you have it. I want to make sure everybody's clear. You got to own it now, though. There's no later. There's way too much to do. I'm going to put letters, and I'm going to make this a... I think I made it a meter stick, right? Did I say that? Yeah, 1 meter. So L is equal to 1 meter, being loose with the sig figs and all that stuff. I'm going to apply a force, either pushing down or pulling down, whichever, of 100 newtons here. And then I'm going to do 1/4 meter out here, B, and halfway through, C, and then green, blue, D, 3/4. And then E, and then another 1/4 of a meter out F. And you could choose the axis of rotation to be anything. Now this is a point number one. Please stop me, have me re-say it. You know, your brain's tired, whatever. It doesn't matter if I say this is red and then you ask, what'd you say? Maybe I meant somewhere else. Okay, so but make sure you follow. What's the torque due to 100 newtons around that axis? Zero. You're not going around it, right? Now, when I say that, I'm not doing the net, right? I'm just looking at that one. What happens depends on all the forces, so I don't know. So just because of my analysis, now I think this is interesting. The same situation, but I'm analyzing it around B. What's the torque around B? Clockwise or counterclockwise? First. I do that, imagining it's the only one. Whatever. I need something right now. Fine, whatever. It's the only one, but if it's torquing around here, it's going to go that way, right? Okay, so it would be counterclockwise. Is that plus or minus? Your choice.
Right,
exactly. Shoulder stroke is the right answer. Is it? You choose. How much is it? How much torque is around B? What's our perpendicular? A quarter. Quarter of a meter. What's a quarter of a meter times 100 newtons? 25 meter newtons, right? Which is close to 25 foot pounds. Everybody cool with that? Now, just because, what's the torque around C? Everybody with me? Half a meter, one half times 150 meter newtons. You can say newton meters. I like meter newtons, so I don't say joules, you know? I can say meter parallel newtons. Which way? Clockwise or counterclockwise?
Okay.
Counterclockwise? Counterclockwise. Look, I'm getting more torque out of this. This is magical engineering. Look, I get more torque. I got 75 meter newtons, right? And now I got 100 meter newtons, still clockwise, counterclockwise, sorry. Now I got 125. Isn't that wild? Now watch this. What if I put G over here? What direction is the torque? Just keep going tangential around. Now it's clockwise. Isn't that weird? What if I do it over here? Well then, something's wrong with me. I gotta have a reason, right? So usually we'll take a physical pivot point. But the value doesn't matter. Just like, what's the position of the pen? I don't know, where's your origin and which way is plus and minus? And we see a recurring theme in this course. There are certain things where the value doesn't matter. How much potential energy? Zero. I don't know. Whatever you want. Plus, minus, where is zero? Right? This is really important. So we look at changes. And the change comes from the net torque. So when you sum it all up, your answer should physically describe what it does. Maybe static equilibrium or rotates. Everybody okay with that? Good. Okay, come on.
Can you say it again?
Yes. Good. I don't know. Let's see. So the amount, that's probably a little different, but the amount of each torque depends on the axis of rotation I choose. But when I choose an axis of rotation, then I can sum up all the torques from all the forces. And it's the net torque that makes it happen. And what happens is what happens, and it doesn't care how you write it up in your math. And so often, it's the net work from all the forces. It's the net torque from all the forces. It's a net impulse from all the external forces. It's a net force from all the forces. And so there's a theme. And the other theme I think in this course strongly, and I'd like us to be better at using this, is that the net, it's the net interaction with others that causes change. And so that's why I like to write those formulas, and I'm encouraging people to do that. So what if now I create a force couple, which simply means equal strength, opposite direction. Now you can apply it anywhere, but I'm going to apply it here. It doesn't matter, you can push it or you can pull it 100 newtons. What's the sum of those forces?
Zero.
When you deal with forces and get this, because it's a lot, it's understandable that it's all blurry, choose coordinates. This is old, right? Force table, right? When you deal with torque, choose an axis. So, what I want you to do is calculate the net force from those two around each axis, fast as you can. But do it on paper, practice your hand speed, and we're gonna do torque A, net from those two, from a force couple, from a couple. A couple of forces, right? From a force couple. From the around each. And what I'd like you to do is write it out. So in general, you're going to have the torque net is equal to the torque from, I don't know what to call it. What should we call this one? I don't know, the left one and this one from the right. Torque from the left force on the left, plus the torque from force on the right. So write out those and then write the answer. So you really see it. Pretty fast, so just use fractions, 1/4, 1/2. Oops, you can do F as well. Probably should have done G. Go fast, and if you're hesitating, whenever you're stuck, then you gotta ask a simpler question. You gotta put the time in until you smooth this out for yourself. This is essential stuff. Any questions? Just call me over. Come on. All good? Does get easy, right? The only thing harder than this is if there's angles. Still just torque net equals I alpha. Throw in some kinematics. Then you've got the structure. Good. As usual, you pick up speed and you get oriented. should be finding something.
It's very useful. Include the plus and minus, make sure you see that. Your choice, you can call it plus, I might call it minus, but we know physically we're still pointing in the same direction. Good. Let's just stop this. So I got the torque around A from the left is what? Zero plus. I'm gonna call counterclockwise positive and clockwise negative. It doesn't matter. So this is gonna be positive or negative?
Torque.
Positive 3/4 times that plus 75 meter newtons. Cool. Is that what you got? And catch me if I make a mistake, right? Now let's go around B. Okay, what's the torque from the left one around B? Positive or negative? Positive. 1/4 times 100 is 25 meter newtons. And from this guy, positive or negative? Just imagine spinning that way. So positive. 1/2 times that is 50 meter newtons. 50 meter newtons. What about around D? Let's jump there. What's the torque from this guy? Positive or negative? Right? Positive. 3/4 times 100 is 75 meter newtons. What's the torque from this guy?
Zero.
So these are nice axes because I get rid of one of my, maybe my unknowns. You don't want to get rid of them all, because what's the point, you know? But that's how we're going to choose a good analysis axis. And it's interesting over here, let's just do F for fun. And F, oops, that's supposed to be F. F, so what's the torque from the left one? 1.25, right?
Yeah.
Or 5/4 times this. Is it positive or negative? Positive. I'm doing F. Positive. 1.25, right? So positive 125 meter newtons. And what about this one? Positive or negative?
That's negative.
This is negative, right? So minus how much? 50 meter newtons. Guess what it's equal to? Positive. And that's a beautiful thing with, so that's an introduction to engineering 255 status. You can do, it's clever because it doesn't matter where you take the axis. And the force adds to zero. So you'll see how that's used. I won't try to show you that. But it's like that. It's like in physics 230, you're going to learn a bunch of basic circuits. And then when you take the circuits class, you're going to take that and go, and the more that you learn it in the 230, initially, it'll be a lot of review, except adding on. And even as you go to upper division, you'll see that in your dynamics engineering class, you just add on to this. And if you know well, not everyone does, and you are ahead of the game. So I want to point out that for the weekend, again, use your schedule. We've still got this next week to finish up rotations and to do oscillation. So if you aren't or haven't taken Math 290, you may need to study the vector product, where we use the cross symbol and sometimes call it the cross product. Take two vectors, multiply them, and get a vector. In a rule, that picks out perpendicular parts. And you can see it's very useful for torque and lots of other things, magnetic force and all kinds of stuff. Very useful rule. The dot or scalar product multiplies parallel parts. This one multiplies perpendicular. You can learn it. You just need to put the time in. And there's YouTube video on that. So we'll do that. And in lab, we're going to do balancing. So let's see. Let me see if I can find the center of mass of an object. Let's do this one. Where do you think the center of mass is? Yeah, it's pretty even, right? I mean, it's not designed that way, so if it's not, you know, that's not its purpose, right? Okay, so what if I put my hand here and I let go? What's it going to do? Right? If I put my hand here, right? So what? Watch this. This is a magic trick. I'm not doing anything. I'm just moving my hands together. Steady. The friction adjusts by how much it leans one way or the other. I'm special. Try it. It's cool. Just, you know, go real. The friction will adjust. If it's leaning one way, you get a little more friction. You go, the center of mass. So the center of mass becomes, I so need to draw. I need a vector. I need more projects, yeah. So I'm going to draw the force of gravity here at the center of mass. What happens if I tilt it? Does that change the center of mass? No, this doesn't care, right? What happens if I bend it? Does that change the center of mass? Where's the center of mass of my arm? Maybe my elbow, right? Now it changes, doesn't it? Okay, so, Max, you guys watch the bridge. Okay, so it can change. You can change your center of mass. But wherever the center of mass is, that's where the force of gravity is. And which way is the gravity? Down, vertically down, right? Vertical is relative to Earth. So no matter what I do. So here's the center mass here. And I can do this axis, but I can do the axis over here. Go over here. Right? Cool. Okay. So where is gravity pulling? Strictly.
Center.
Everywhere.
Everywhere.
Every single piece. But I can analyze it as being there, right? So I can calculate the torque around this axis. If I lean it up against the wall, it's still there, but vertically down. Don't go like that. I've seen it. Why? Because people are dumb. No, because they're overwhelmed. Right? You stop thinking physically and you just do stuff that you go, I can't believe I did that. Well, join the human race, right? Especially when you're overwhelmed, but it's just down. What I need is, I need a little hole here to pivot. Right? Wouldn't that be cool? Okay. No matter what I do. That handles every single piece. And we're going to do lab. And it doesn't matter where I balance it. Look at the force of gravity. The force of gravity here at the center mass handles these pieces too. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. It handles, so it's gonna go, it's gonna torque that way. If I put that over there, it's gonna torque that way. Does that make sense? Where's the center mass of this guy? Okay, let's wait. Where's the center mass of this? Here, right? So if I go like this, make up for my balancing ability, then I should balance it, right? Notice this, if I tilt it this way, then that vector goes here, right? And I can balance it by pushing up on the center mass to counterbalance the force of gravity, right? Where's the center mass of this? In the middle, watch. Oh, it doesn't work. Right? But I can balance it by going like that. table does better than I do. It pushes up through the center mass, and gravity acts on every piece as though it were at the center mass. Cool? And if I tilt it, then it falls one way or the other, acting as though all... So that's a pretty cool tool. Where now is the center mass of this guy? It's got to be at the beak. How do you do that? You put little weights in it, you know? And you design it. This is engineering. But you have to have insight into physics and hands-on stuff and experiment and math and AutoCAD and MATLAB and all that good stuff. These are the tools of engineering. That's why engineers do great stuff, right? It's so cool. It's so cool. And it's pretty stable. Notice it's a stable equilibrium. Stable equilibrium because I can move it away and it comes back. And I can rotate. And I can oscillate, and I can make little waves, and that kind of models the early model of an electron going around a, okay, never mind, the Broglie waves. It's all really cool. And this first step has been hard, I know that, but go strong because it pays off. Where's the center mass of this thing? How do I find it? Where do you think it is? Closer to your right or your left? Because there's more over there, right? So, what if I cut it in half and I thought of two pieces? Which would have more mass? The right or the left? If I cut that in half and I had two pieces, where's the center mass? This goes. No matter what I do with it, the center mass is there. So if I cut it in half, which piece has more mass?
Are they the same?
Now you got to prove it. Your boss is asking for this question because your boss is a manager and not an engineer, and everybody laughs at your boss, but there are those bosses that are engineers and managers, like, say, Bill Gates or someone that actually know what they're talking about. And then you go. So how do I analyze it? So see if you can write something down on paper to analyze that problem. You know where the center mass of the whole thing is, but what if I get a left side and a right side? Where's the center mass of each side? I just gave you the biggest hint in the world. And the question is, which has more mass, the left or the right? This is your left, this is your right. I'll be on your side of the thing. Which one has more mass? Do you see the physics? Draw it. You want to prove it to yourself. Knee-jerk sometimes is wrong. Take it to the point where you would take it to your boss or colleagues or whatever, and you'd say, this is correct. I'm not guessing. Look at my picture. You can't argue with me. Center of mass of the whole thing is, we're going to balance it there. And the question is, which side has more mass? The trick is to locate the center mass of each side separately.
have it? Because I'm not going to tell you. You know everything you need, no crutches. But speaking of crutches, they are useful, and you know, you can put them in static equilibrium and everything. So what I want you to do for this weekend, try to do some every day, including today. Try. It's hard. Just try it. And then this weekend, do the videos and et cetera, and try practice the vector cross product. Do these problems. Ladders, beams, you know, hold a sign. Could be a beam this way, that way, that way. Right? We have a hinge. We're going to talk about that. Should have done that. No, we haven't got time. We'll do that one. I'm going to have you draw a free body of this. Try feeling that. See if you can model it. It's going to be a surprise. So beams, hanging masses, ladders, someone walking up a ladder, right? What are the forces? Just good old free body diagrams. Good. Same old thing. You want, if you got to add the forces, choose a coordinate system. Usually when we're talking about the civil engineering, you know, you worry about gravity. So vertical and horizontal are common axes. But then, coordinate axes, but then you need a rotation axis. Choose one that gets rid of some of your unknowns and keep some of the other ones. I'll tell you this one thing. When you have a hinge, what we do is we break it up and we say there's two forces at the hinge. There's one vertical, one, if you happen to know it's down, fine, and horizontal. If you happen to know it's in, fine, but if you don't, it'll all work out. So treat a hinge as two forces, a horizontal and vertical one. Two forces, components to that. And try doing that this weekend. We're gonna do the lab, and we have a lot of time to do some problems, but do as many as you can. Try to work together and do this. I'm going to move the homework to Tuesday night. So, but you've also got oscillation stuff. So I know some people are trying to go strong because, you know, it just works better. But try to do some, if you're stuck or whatever, work together. We've also got this 12C. Yeah, we've also got the 12C, and then we've got the chapter 14 oscillations. Good news, it's not as complicated. If you're taking differential equations, it's going to be easy for you, but if not, it's fine. Remember that torque is in your motors, it's in your body, it's all around, so have a good weekend, and keep away.
So,
well,
that's supposed to be today, you're moving it to Tuesday.
Yep. The one that's due today is going to be Tuesday. I expect lunch but if you're doing it, do more, have fun, see it. I know, and then the finishing chapter 12, 12C, I'm not sure where I'm going to put that. I don't know. I'll look online. I'll think about it. I got to think about the pace of the course. And then if you're in there, start in with oscillations, because that's super powerful stuff too. Rotations, oscillations, waves are the bread and butter of science and engineering. So.